Are you ready or what? I thought this was going to be the first one I missed. So like sooner or later it has to happen. Well, it wouldn't have been me screwing up, but someone screwed up. I made it. How long have we got here? Are they going to kick us out? Like in an hour? They've closed the bar, so everyone's going to get. Other than these, they're mine. Okay, so we haven't tested a lot, but let me just jump into it and we'll just wing it and we'll see how it all goes. Let's say. The reason I like these is that this is what like your normal everyday people see about security, right? Like this is the impression that they get. I've got another really short one that I like as well. Try this one.
For weeks I've been investigating the cabbie killer murders with a certain morbid fascination.
Process is really a lot slower and a lot more methodical. It's very carefully thought out. There's normally gloves and masks and things involved. We know that because we watch the news, and every time we see a hacker, there's a mask and gloves and everything else. So a bit of what I'm going to talk about today is just to try and disseminate some of the perceptions of what goes on with the reality, and certainly some of the things that I've been seeing. For a little bit of context first, obviously, I'm a bit late. It took me 53 hours to get here. From Australia, I am Australian, and some of you may have worked out by now. This is what Australia looks like at the moment. You know, you guys are cold. This is Australia. They had to invent new colours, basically, for how hot it gets. It gets. See, I had a lot of time while I was waiting for this, so I was like, oh, there's going to put some random stuff in there. It gets so hot that that this guy was in the news the other day. Anyone know what that is? That's what happens when you get into your car after it's been sitting in the sun. Real thing, get branded. It is so hot in Australia that our thongs stick to the road. And all of you are going, what did you say? No, really, they're thongs, trust me, Google it. Put your location as Australia before you do it. Otherwise you'll get what you think you're gonna get. Maybe Google it anyway, I don't know. So to pivot nicely from that to Australia and InfoSec, I thought what I should do is show a little bit about some of the sort of government perceptions of security as well. And there are some world leaders that have said some pretty stupid stuff lately. And who do you think I was going to say? So this was one of our last prime ministers. We basically have a different prime minister every week at the moment. Like one person comes in, then we boot them out, and someone else comes in. So this was Malcolm Turnbull. We booted him out. And we've been having a lot of discussion in Australia around effectively government interception into encrypted communications. Because the governments have said, and I kind of get where they're going with this, they've said there's a lot of encryption out there now. It's actually pretty hard for us to see some of the stuff that we really need to see. And well, all right, that sounds reasonable. You've kind of been seeing a lot of stuff you didn't need to see as well, but that's another issue. So Malcolm's doing this press conference with the AFP, that's Australian Federal Police. And one of the journalists has said, look, you're basically hedging around, like banning encryption. And he said, you know, encryption's just... It's not just you, right? It's like, we have this shit at home as well. So So he's gone. In Australia as well, we've been dealing with data breaches like everywhere else in the world. And we just got our first mandatory data breach disclosure scheme last year. It's called the Notifiable Data Breach Scheme. And as a result of that, we're now starting to see a lot of disclosures that we wouldn't have seen before. And we had one of our largest banks in Australia, which was the Combank, have to do a disclosure last year. And for context, when we say large bank, we're like tens of billions of dollars worth of revenue every year. And what seems to have eventuated is that Combank were decommissioning a data center somewhere. And as part of this decommissioning of the data center, they had to load all of the old data, like the tapes, the disks, everything, onto a truck. And they literally drive the truck to a secure destruction facility. And there appears to have been an incident along the way, and I have some file footage of the Commonwealth Bank truck just here, and it's loaded up with all the data. So that funny were it not for the fact that this does appear to actually be plausible. And it's plausible insofar as KPMG went and audited them and they said, we retraced the route of the truck to determine where they could locate the drives along this route. It might have fallen off, but we couldn't find any data left on the side of the road, so maybe it didn't. Low bar, right? Low bar. So a lot of what I'm going to talk about is related to Have I Been Pwned. Who's used Have I Been Pwned before? All right, excellent. For those of you who want stickers, there's summer in there. I do have them, trust me. Thank you. So what seems to happen, so you come into the conference, have you got the stickers? I might have some things to say as well. No, we just want the stickers. So Have I Been Pwned is a data breach aggregation service. Website gets hacked, leaks all over the place. I put in there, you search for it. So a lot of us have been in different data breaches. Has anyone been in, say, the Dropbox data breach? I was in that one. LinkedIn data breach? Ashley Madison data breach? Now, so here's the interesting thing. It's always one person and it's always a guy. And I know this is going to sound really surprising. But we also know, as a result of the breach, that it was mostly guys. And one of the reasons we know that is because we looked at the data and went, there's a lot of women here who signed up from IP address 127.0.0.1. Isn't that interesting? And because their breach disclosed not just the data, but also the web application and a whole bunch of their emails as well, we know from reverse engineering the code that they were basically just bots. They called them engagers. So Ashley Madison's business model is predicated on chatbots engaging with men to give them just that little sense of opportunity so that they would pay money for the service. You know, as if it didn't sound shady enough already. So we learned all of these really interesting things from data breaches. I updated these stats this morning. There's another breach sitting there with another 20 million records or something that's waiting to go. Write something in code. Some friends of mine might use it, that'd be nice. And I put it out there, not expecting it to go anywhere. And we go on a few years, and I guess the epitome of where it ended up going is I ended up here in the US in Congress about 18 months ago. And this was a big thing for me because I had to get dressed up, which is really unusual. And I kid you not, literally everything you see me wearing, I had to go and buy. So I didn't have the shirt or tie or anything like that. I literally live on a beach in Australia, and this is very dressed up, trust me. So I had to go and buy all this stuff, and you know, the guys next to me are very serious looking as well, so I had to fit in. But I kind of didn't want to overdo it too much, so I went and I got some cool socks. In fact, I put out a tweet, I said, look, I've got to go and be serious and presentable, can anyone give me some cool socks? And Sophos sent me these socks, and it says, for those about to code, we salute you. So I wore those to Congress, and got that nice photo. So I didn't kind of want to take it too seriously, you know? So getting back to the whole sort of data breach topic, one of the things that obviously I've done is given it this name, the Pwned name. And at the time, it was like I didn't really think about it, I just thought, oh, this would be a bit of fun. And I didn't know that it would then get a lot of traction with consumers and media and things like this. And they'd all start asking this question about what Pwned means. And I've had to sort of try and explain to people what the term means. And I'll say, look, I mean, an example of this would be you're on your trampoline and you fall off your trampoline and then the dog comes. This would be Pwned. And everyone agrees, right? They're like, yes, that would be fair. Down in Australia, you might be standing around and some of that happens. Also Pwned. Putting it back in context, InfoSec-wise, you could be a French journalist talking about how your company's Twitter account got Pwned whilst your company's Twitter account credentials were pasted on the wall behind you. This would also be Pwned. Low bar. There's a theme here. So, with the benefit of hindsight, I think the name was actually good. A few people said to me more recently, they're like, oh, now it's grown up, you should change the name. And I'm like, no. This is good fun. I was on Italian TV the other day, and it sounds so funny when they say it, so Pwned. So onto the data side of things. One of the incidents recently, which was really noteworthy, related to the fact that there's just so much data floating around on different dark web websites. And I always kind of, I'm in two minds when I see these headlines. Like every one of these headlines is a dark web something or other. And on the one hand, okay, it's awareness for the industry and people start thinking about it, it's great. On the other hand, I think that most people out there reading some of these news outlets, and these are sort of major mainstream consumer news outlets as well, see dark web and they're like, wow, that sounds pretty scary. That must be like hard to get to. I think in their minds, it's like going down to the docks at night to buy like illegal firearms or drugs or something, I don't know. But what I've been finding is that there is that, but a huge amount of the data is just public, clear web, really easily accessible as well. But to sort of start that dark website, you know, a few examples. We saw these pop up recently. The Register actually published a piece back in Jan where they announced a whole bunch of, in fact, no, it was last month, it was very recent, a whole bunch of different data breaches that companies didn't know about. It's like, hey, MyFitnessPal, you've had, you know, 100 something million records breached, and Howes has had this many, and MyHeritage as well, they're all on this list. And the first a lot of these companies knew was like the Register posting a piece about, yeah, tens of millions from here, hundreds of millions from there. And what they've done is they've gone through and just looked at one of these dark web forums and found incidents like this. So here we've got Giphy Cat, is being sold by vendor Gnostic Players. 5 stars, good guy, this one. So if you were gonna buy like an illegal data breach, it's the guy you go to. So it's, you know, I suspect this audience is probably a little bit more aware of the dark web marketplaces and so on, but for most people, I think they get a little bit of a shock of how mainstream it feels. Like it feels like going to eBay, you know, oh, I can see a vendor and a price and where it ships and ratings and all this sort of thing. And this is what was actually in here. So this was a description of why Giphy Cat was being sold by Gnostic Players. They wanted to free George Duke Cullen, a young and talented boy. So this is actually a political standpoint. He's a kid who got arrested in the UK for trying to hack into military things, which, you know, probably seems fair enough to get arrested after that. So it's politically motivated, but please give me Bitcoin, apparently. Now this bloke has got some good ratings here, and the ratings of course are very important on these marketplaces because you don't really have a lot of recourse if the product isn't good. Like you don't go to your local consumer protection agency and went, hey, I bought this data breach gun heroin. I've got a bunch of snapshots here of breaches or collections of breaches that do just appear on the clear web. So I see a lot of this. A lot of people send me links around to things like this, which is just a directory listing of files. And if you look through this, you'll see some stuff that is probably familiar. I mean, Ashley Madison is down there toward the bottom. So here we have a data breach with tens of millions of people in there and their deepest personal secrets. A data breach that several people killed themselves over, and someone's got it just sitting there. Anyone can go and download it for free. Came across this one in Russia. Similar sort of thing. So a bunch of these already have been pwned. Things like acne.org. I mean, it's a website for acne. It's, you know, the most sort of inoffensive, benign thing possible. That's over there. You can go and download all that. This one popped up just the other day. Same sort of thing. I'm seeing things like Adobe in there. My data's in there twice. Adult Friend Finder. Similar sort of deal to Ashley Madison. A few others there we're not going to talk about on stage. You can probably work them out by the name. So a lot of this data is just sitting there in the clear, in public. And as much as these headlines of dark web and everything are kind of scary, like, let's not underestimate just how much is sitting out there easily accessible to anyone. One of the things that I see a lot of as well is forums redistributing this. So this is Raid Forum, and Raid Forum is probably the most well-known, maybe notorious is the right word, for redistributing this class of data. And in fact, we can see here someone's redistributing data from underworldempireforums.com. Now, you've got to have some credits. You can get credits by redistributing data yourself, so it sort of encourages the self-propagation of information. And if you pay some credits, then you get the download link and you get the data, and now it's spread to get one more place. It's interesting to look at how people chime in on this as well. So we've got this guy just here. You know, choosing an avatar to try and be as offensive as he possibly can, obviously. And then saying, thank you for this one, man. I really do appreciate it. Quite polite, actually, despite the Nazi imagery. So, you know, grabbing again tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of records. And even if they're just credential pairs, even if they're just email addresses and passwords, they're going to be the email addresses and passwords that unlock people's accounts in untold other places, which is why we've got this problem with credential stuff at the moment. Also to see exclusive content like this poster. It's just a casual, happy forum. I saw another one pop up recently where you could search through data breaches and find all the passwords for an email address. And you would literally just enter the email address here, solve the capture, and it would come back and say, here are all the passwords this account has used. Now, this is probably a pretty benign example, but you could put, say, my email address in there, and it would come back with passwords from previous breaches which had been cracked. Embarrassing passwords from long ago, because the problem is I've been on the internet long enough to have embarrassing passwords, as many of you probably have as well. So this particular one, he says, look, if you find yourself there and you'd like your data to be removed, send 10 Bitcoin. It's like a shakedown, right? It's like, well, it'd be a shame if something was to happen to your data. You know, give me $10 worth of Bitcoin and I'll delete it. This guy's kind of generous as well, because he said if you donate $1,750 worth of Bitcoin, he'll shut the whole thing down. A little while, then it gets shut down, and then two more pop up, and they just propagate over and over and over again. It's interesting to look at the way they're justified as well. So I see justifications like this. So there's one out there at the moment where they're selling access to data. If anyone remembers LeakSource, they shut down a couple of years, similar to that, where you search for an email address and says, hey, we found data, give us some money and we'll tell you what the data is. A bunch of people sent me my data. Not just like my email address, not just my password, but other personal data from breaches because sites like this sell it. So this one site has this section where they say, is it legal? And then they explain that once a site has been hacked and the database in the hands of a number of individuals not related to the hack, it is considered public information. What do you reckon? They go on. As researchers, we're allowed to distribute and allow users to search for information. So the way they try to justify it is they say, it's research. And in the terms and conditions, it says you will only search for your own. collection one. And this got a lot of traction in January when multiple people popped up and contacted me and said, look, I have got a massive credential stuffing list. So credential stuffing lists are just email addresses and passwords. You don't necessarily have context as to where they've come from, but they're pairs which work somewhere, and due to the prevalence of password reuse, may work somewhere else as well. So multiple people said, hey, there's this collection one thing. You might want to put in, have I been pwned? And I looked at it and found 773 million unique records. Loaded in on the 17th of Jan last month. This says the 16th of Jan because America's behind Australia, just saying. So I loaded it there, anyway. And then it ended up all over the news. So it ended up in Wired magazine, ended up in CNET, ended up in Fortune, and this sort of goes to my point in the opening where this kind of stuff hits. Did it or not, I've got the data, you're in there. So I've got to go and see what checks are put in there now. But anyway, it hits all these mainstream consumer news outlets. Now this was collection one, 773 million records, about 80 gigabytes worth of data. After this, I had all these people popping up going, when are you going to load collections 2, 3, 4, and 5? And I said, oh crap, not more data. And there was like a terabyte worth of data. And to the point about it being distributed before, it's all over Twitter. This tweet, when I checked it a few days ago, is still there. So here's a terabyte worth of email addresses and passwords, mine are in there multiple times, yours probably are as well, on Twitter with links to MegaNZ, and all that data was still on MegaNZ as well, hadn't been taken down. So when we talk about sort of the distribution of data, it's just totally out of control. I don't know how you put the lid on it. The thing is then, and we sort of keep coming back to this low bar, because this is what worries me, right? I mean, okay, we worry about nation states and everything, but what really worries me with what I do is the number of people that have access to data and just absolutely no moral fortitude about what they do with it. And I'll give you an example of that. So people get this data and they use automated tools to mount credential stuffing attacks. And it very often happens on Spotify. So I found a little video here on YouTube about someone who has a tool, a written tool, and they're telling people how to use this tool to take lists like these and check them against Spotify.
Anyway, what is going on with these? And welcome back to eBrand.
Checker is mate. Now, by his voice, either a child or a very young adult, right? There are plenty of videos out there where it's like, yeah, your voice hasn't broken yet. Like, I know where to peg you age-wise. All right, let's see how it works.
But before we start, I just want to say that.
So many Spotify accounts and you can't remember which ones work, you need to download this tool to check them in bulk.
It will also tell you guys if the account is a Spotify.
Alright, let's go on. But I hear from people all the time. I get these emails constantly, even over the weekend, someone saying, Spotify's been hacked because I just got alerted to a paste in Have I Been Pwned and it's got my real Spotify credentials. And I look at the email the person sent me, and I look at the paste, and I look at the password, and I go, yeah, you got a different problem, mate. So, credential stuffing keeps happening. Now, we sort of touched on password strength because we saw a bunch of those passwords and they were terrible. And I thought we'd kind of go down the rabbit hole of passwords for a moment and go back a few decades to this image here. This is MIT in the 60s. And I always find this photo interesting because this is apparently the first ever instance of a password on a computer system. And it's kind of interesting to think about how we did authentication then and who our threat actors were. So who were we worried about circumventing things like password controls? And I guess the first thing is that this is like a room of computer. It's the 60s, it's not internet connected. You had to have physical presence. So you had to get on site and you had to be there in person. You then had to get into the room physically and you had to know what to do with this. And if I got into that room today, I would have absolutely no idea. I don't know. Taped punch cards, or did they have discs in the 60s? I don't know. Wasn't born. So back then, though, the way we did authentication was we had two strings. We had a username and a password in the system, username and password in your head. If the ones in your head match the ones in the systems, bang, you're good to go. And for the vast majority of systems today, this is still the way we do it. It's like string matching. Do we match strings? If someone else knows my strings, they can get into my account. So this was problematic, but we could kind of get away with it in the 60s because it was just the one system. There was no password reads. It's like, well, I've only got one. But if we fast forward, we start moving forward into the 80s, we start getting into more connected systems and connected systems that mere mortals have in their homes. So this was a Prestel. And a Prestel was one of the sort of early dial-up-based systems. You'd literally plug it into your PC, it had an acoustic coupler, you'd chuck it on the modem, it would squeal and screech and you'd get connected. Now this was like massively cutting edge high tech in the 80s. So the BBC did this documentary on it, and there's this little clip with a guy who shows you how to log into Prestel. Now keep in mind, there are about 90,000 people that use Prestel around the world. So you now have threat actors that are remote, and you've got a bunch of them, and the sophistication level is much lower. So let's see how he logs on.
The Prestel computer is now asking me to enter my own personal password.
So the thing is, like, you look at it from the human perspective, right? Like, the human is just trying to get online to do the thing that they wanted to humanly do. And they're like, oh, there's something in my way. It's a password. What's the easiest way of getting past the thing that's in my way? An easily predictable pattern. And we still see this password today. Every time there's some news outlet does the roundup of what's 2018's worst passwords, you'll still have, like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, because there's a bunch of systems out there that allow it. So this is problematic because now we're in this situation, right, where we've actually got tens of thousands of people around the world. And if they're all using these terribly predictable passwords, well, we've got account takeover problems and things like that. So we fast forward a couple of decades and now we're in internet era. And we're getting millions of websites and hundreds of millions, eventually billions of people connected to the internet. And they're all trying to create accounts. So we as sort of smart, scientific, technical people said, well, the way we're going to fix this is we'll add password complexity criteria. And what that means is we're going to make passwords stronger. Air quote, stronger. So there's a bit of file footage here. This is Bob. Bob's trying to create a password. To create passwords. And we've all been there in one way or another. Either we've tried to create a stupidly weak password and the site said no, or how many times have you tried to create a strong password and the site's gone, I'm sorry, you have too many characters. You have a special character. And I'm like, aren't all characters special? Like, it's 2019, for God's sake. Get with the times. So we have like these arbitrary criteria that stop us from being successful. And for those who want to always be the lowest common denominator, like the guy trying to log on to the Presto with 1234, they get the password complexity criteria and they solve it like this. And this is a good password. Crickets. Because you're looking at it going, no, it's not a good password. But we've got to kind of like divide down the issues here, because from the perspective of just the mathematical criteria, it has a lowercase and uppercase, a number, a non-alphanumeric, and it's 15 characters long. And this like ticks every measurable quality of a password. You could go to pretty much any website and create this password. Those same websites are going to block your four-word passphrase because it has a space in it or it doesn't have an uppercase. Now, the problem is that you can go into pretty much any place of work and create this password on the system. If you do that, what's going to happen in 3 months' time? Have to change it, right? What are you going to do in 3 months' time? Everyone has done this. Yes, exactly. I love the way, no matter where I do this talk, like I ask that question, everyone's like, yeah, you just increment the number at the end. And you just keep going and going and going. And this is like our human propensity to circumvent technological constraints. I certainly did this myself at my last place of work. And what I discovered is that as you go and you keep incrementing the numbers, you can take, and you can all do this in your heads now with your password for work, which does this. You can take that last number, divide it by four, and that's how long you've been at the company. Does it work? It does. I know you all do it because I've seen your passwords. So this is the humans trying to get around this barrier. And the thing is, like, this arbitrary rotation thing as well, like, it never kind of made sense to me. You know, and the thing that doesn't make sense is, hacker gets your password, and then they're like, oh, they've got busy, their family commitments, they're going to go on holiday, something like that. I'll get to it in 3 months' time, or are they going to go and use it? You know, like, that just never quite gelled. And there's always this gap of, well, what happens if there was an exposure, let's say in log files, 4 months ago? You know, well, this would save you from that. Well, yes, but there are also lots of other things that could save you as well. And this is an anti-pattern in terms of password strength. So one of the things I really like at the moment is there are organizations out there saying that this kind of sucks because they're very, very conscious of the human element. So a good example of this is the NCSC. So they're part of GCHQ in the UK, the spy agency over there. And the great thing about them is I've said, I only ask users to change their passwords on indication of suspicion of compromise. And suddenly we're going, oh yeah, that kind of makes sense. And in fact, they said a bunch of stuff. Between them and NIST, they came out with a bunch of really interesting guidance. And it included things like this. It included things like, do not restrict characters. I think everyone's behind that. Do not restrict the paste function because people use password managers. Do not require arbitrary password complexity rules. So don't require an uppercase and a lowercase and everything else. So there's a whole bunch of stuff which enhances usability. And then on the other hand, because we are taking some things away, like we're taking rotation away, they're saying you should have other mechanisms of identifying fraudulent behavior. So use behavioral analytics. You know, like Bob comes into the office every week and he downloads data from the sales SharePoint site or something like that, and then Bob comes in one day and he downloads 50 gigabytes worth of data from marketing. Maybe it's not Bob. Maybe we should be a bit smarter and not just look at this whole sort of stream matching idea, which we always used to do. Now, thinking about the problem with the arbitrary complexity rules and the rotation and the shortcuts that people then take in order to meet those criteria, I was reminded of this last year. I don't know if everyone remembers this guy, but remember in Hawaii last year, there was an emergency warning system. And Cloud pets data breach, for example. Well, there's a lot of passwords in here that are literally cloud pets. Maybe the data's from cloud pets, because this is what people do. The bit about corpuses, though, and this one came from NIST. NIST said, you should think about blacklisting passwords obtained from previous breach corpuses. And I thought that was quite interesting, because it's sort of saying, regardless of how many funny characters or uppercases or lowercases or anything you have in your password, if it is circulating publicly and other people have seen it, maybe it's not a very good password anymore. Maybe you end up on the Spotify guy's video. So NIST said you should do that, but they never actually gave you the passwords. And I thought, well, I've got a lot of passwords, and have I been home? So I went and built out this feature here, which is under the passwords link here. And all you do is you go here and you put your password in. Everyone cool with this? All right, so let me explain how this works. When I originally built this, I said, look, this is a way to check if your password has been seen in data breaches. And as of today, there's 551 million unique passwords from different data breaches. And I said, look, it's a way to check a password. And I had a big piece of bold text there. And the bold text said, do not enter your real password that you currently use. If you're worried it's been compromised, change it and then come here and check it. So then it was all over the press, and the press was like, go and enter your password here right now. I was like, oh, crap. But I kind of went, okay, I told them not to do it, but they're doing it anyway. If the outcome of this is that a whole bunch of people find that their password is terrible, which we know is going to happen, and they go and change it, maybe not so bad. So that was sort of the original position. Since then, it's changed a bit. And I want to sort of show you how this works. We came up with a model. This is Cloudflare itself. In fact, to their credit, Cloudflare came up with it, and I just got to take the credit. Or changes their password, they hit that API, it's super fast, it's all cached in Cloudflare. All they do is send me those five characters, I have no idea what it is, but when they bring it back, if they've seen that password more than X number of times, so some organizations, for example, say, look, if I've seen the password once before, meh, don't really care about it. If I've seen it 51,000 times before, probably not very good. So as of today, that API gets hit about 8 million times a day from different organizations around the world trying to stop people using passwords that have been breached before. If you're paranoid, or if you just don't want to have the external dependency, you can download all of these passwords and run them locally. So this is what GitHub does. If you sign into GitHub with a Pwned password, they come back and say, hey, this password is on Have I Been Pwned? You really shouldn't be using it anymore. So that's out there, it's 100% free, it's supported by Cloudflare, and the main thing that they do is they really aggressively cache the API, And they cache all their downloadable files as well, because there's many, many terabytes every month that people put down on that. Okay, so that's the password side of things. Something different. I go through a lot of disclosures with companies where someone has sent me their data, and it's normally like some random person on the internet. You know, I don't know if they're legit. I try and verify the data, but then as part of the process, I don't want to do basically what happened on the register, where the first thing a company learns about their data breach is it's public. I'd rather they find out privately. And then, you know, like you think about it, maybe it was due to SQL injection and the flaw's still there. If I publicize it, other people don't find it. If it's not that, if it's just like a database backup from years ago and they've cleaned it up, I'd still rather they handle the communication with customers rather than just chucking them under the bus. So I'll get in touch with companies. And a couple of years ago, I got in touch with these guys, Lifeboat. And Lifeboat is a Minecraft service. So you could go to Lifeboat, go and get yourself a Minecraft server. And they had somewhere in the order of 7 million accounts, plain text passwords too, thank you very much. 7 million accounts floating around. And after getting in touch with them, and this hadn't been disclosed anywhere, I was searching, 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 couldn't find it. They came back and said, yeah, we haven't disclosed it. The reason why is we figured the best thing for our players was to quietly force a password reset without letting the hackers know they had limited time to act. What? So basically, you're resetting the passwords on your service, which of course are the same as the passwords on every other service the person uses, because this is what humans do, and you don't tell anyone, and you lost their data, and you leaked it, and you knew about it, and you covered it up. And depending on where you are in the world, you kind of get into trouble for this now as well. And what I think they didn't quite get, and this came through in the tweets later on, is one girl sent this tweet and said, literally all my passwords, social media, servers, email, etc., were this password. Do I have to change them all? Yeah. Probably not to the same one while you're there. And so here's reality of it as well. No matter how insignificant you think your service is, if you're holding passwords, you're holding the passwords to people's email and their social media profiles and God knows what else because of password reuse. And I think people miss this. I often hear from people who say, oh, I'm building a site and it's like a cat forum, you know? I don't really have to worry about password storage. And Lifeboat decided that the best thing to do was to boast about how their data breach was bigger than the other data breach. Here's where we are. Competition. Should be like golf. Smaller is better. So I had another guy pop up, and this was another Twitter one. And this guy had actually dumped a whole bunch of stuff publicly before. And he put this post out and he said, look, BlueSnap, 324,000 records, Mega NZ link again, Mega is very, very popular for redistributing data breaches, IP email, and other stuff, including credit card information. Link to publicly, easily downloadable, so I took a copy of it. It actually took a while before I got to look at it. It was like 6 weeks or something. And when I drilled into it, it kind of looked like this. Now, this is one person's record out of 324,000. And this is about 20% of the record. Everything obfuscated in grey is personally identifiable info, name, address, phone number. Everything in red is credit card data. The red arrow is what you're probably thinking it sounds like. It was the CVV. And it's a little bit unusual to see that in a breach like this. Like we see card data every now and then, to see like the full and then if I load a breach, they get automated emails. So I contacted a few of them and said, look, there's an alleged breach, alleged, and your card data is in there. can you help me verify whether this is you? And I give them a little bit of data. So I'll give them like the first number of the security code. And if they confirm that's right, I'll say, look, would you mind giving me the last number? Because obviously where we're going here, it's probably going to be your full number, but I'd like to have this sort of double confirmation. Turned out it was legit. So 324,000 records. Now, the problem was the previous slide said BlueSnap. And what one of the issues with breaches like this is the attribution as well. Are we really confident it's BlueSnap? You can't just go to BlueSnap and like plug in someone's email address and try and do a password reset and see if it comes back and says, yes, the account exists. Because BlueSnap is a payment processor. And when I looked at the data, there was all these references to a company called RegPack as well. And RegPack does these little registration forms, which you embed on the site with a little bit of JavaScript, and then they do payment fulfillment through BlueSnap. And in my mind, the workflow was such that if you were seeing RegPack somewhere sort of further upstream and BlueSnap, it was probably going to be from RegPack. So when I contacted them both, I said, look, I think this is one of you. Which one is it? They're both like, nah, not us, not us. I said, all right, fair enough. I'm going to write a blog post. Give me some statements. So RegPack gave me a statement, said this. We have run the full security protocol implemented in these cases and concluded. So they tried to downplay. They've still got this statement on their website. Bulletproof security. All communications always encrypted. Service had the same thing. Capgemini backed up Michael Page data, which is a recruitment company that runs in most of the rest of the world except for the US. Same sort of thing. So it's interesting to sort of see all these like massive claims of security prowess and then see what the reality behind it is. And I thought I'd end on something which kind of perfectly illustrates that, because I saw something pop up in my feed recently, which was this. And this is a biometric pattern. And it must have seemed like a really good idea at the time, until I put the screw inside. And this isn't even a good bit. This padlock is invincible to people who do not have a screwdriver. And I kind of feel like that's what a lot of our InfoSec is like today too. All right. Can I relax now? All right, who's got questions? I am.
So we know one password is generated by, who was the other one you mentioned?
Firefox does as well.
So what is the most innovative use of the new
solution? Oh, good question. So for those of you who didn't hear, what's the most innovative use of my API that I've seen? The most innovative use, I have an immediate answer for that, is Okta. Now, normally I have a lapel mic, so I'm trying to do all this with one hand. Pwned passwords in practice. related apples, Google. So, most of you probably know Okta, Pwned passwords in practice. And I wanted to write this blog post about the way people have used it. And if we go here, real world examples of it, and we do a control F for OKTA. All right, so here we go. So Okta. I think they've done an awesome job of that. You got a mic coming right there.
Hey, good evening. I've heard about there's a new technology coming out for like passwordless authentication. Do you think that the passwordless authentication will solve all these problems?
So your mic doesn't work, but I think you said passwordless authentication doesn't solve all our problems?
Yeah.
No. Any other questions? there's always a password killer. Oh, I thought you'd bring me a bottle opener. Just saying. There's always all these ideas. No, I'm serious. And the main reason is that, let's face it, passwords are sucky, right? For all the reasons we just saw. People choose terrible ones, they forget them, they store them bad ways, they reuse them. All of that is really, really sucky. There are really, really good technical solutions. There are obviously things like U2F keys, fantastic technical solution. There are various implementations where people use everything from sort of QR codes to just simple emails, which sends you effectively a password reset to log you straight in. The one thing that passwords do better than absolutely everything else is that everyone knows how to use them. Like, they're so bad in so many ways, but whether you're technical, like most of us probably are, or with, let's say, a non-technical spouse or elderly parents or something like that, everyone knows how to use a password. And they use terrible ones, but they all know how to use it. So when we get to the point where some marketing manager is sitting down wanting to get a site launched and wanting to get people to register, because that's how the company makes money and employs people like us, they're like, what's the lowest friction way? So I don't see anything killing passwords in any meaningful way for quite some time. I do see the prevalence with which we use them changing. So, you know, I've got an iPhone, so I've got Face ID. I've got fingerprint readers on all my laptops. I have to use passwords a lot less frequently, but I've still got them. I can't even set the iPhone up without putting in three passwords. Like, one is for the Wi-Fi, and then one is to restore from iCloud, and then one is because I need a PIN as a fallback position. So I've got more passwords than ever, I just don't have to use them as much. So I don't see anything sort of, you know, the passwordless mechanisms, there's a few out there, but nothing's really fundamentally changed the landscape yet.
So what are your thoughts on FIDO?
I think FIDO is a great idea, and I think the FIDO implementations on things like U2F keys, and also things like AuthN as well, when you sort of combine all these things together, they've got great potential. We need to take people through a learning curve though, because what we're saying is that the old sucky thing that you knew how to do, we're going to replace with something else. It's a little bit like, why are knowledge-based authentication questions still a thing? That's why I went to Congress, because they're like, we have so many data breaches and everyone knows everyone's date of birth. Can we actually still be a bank and call up and ask for a date of birth to identify verification? No, you can't. We still do it because everyone knows how to relay their date of birth or their first dog or whatever else. What password manager do I use? So I use 1Password. Let me be clear, the password manager called 1Password. So I've used that for the last 8 years or so, and they recently started partnering with Have I Been Pwned as well. So you see 1Password there. I like those guys because they're very much on our wavelength, for want of a better term. So without naming names, I've spoken to a lot of other password managers. They tend to be big conglomerates. I end up speaking to a marketing manager somewhere or a salesperson. The 1Password folks I all met at Loco Moco Sec in Hawaii last year, just really nice people that you want to sit there and have a beer with and take this very seriously. And they've done all the technical things like extensive audits. They have $100,000 bug bounty if you can get into the keychain of someone. I like the people and I like what they do. But you know, that said, frankly, any password manager, even a notebook, is better than what most people are doing today, which is reusing passwords. All right, who else?
Hello. Have you seen any interesting trends in the responses from companies that have been breached before or after you log up?
Yeah. It's kind of funny. Someone asked me the other day, they said, do you think big companies respond better? I think it's almost like tech-centric companies respond well. In fact, let me answer it by giving you good examples, then I'll give you bad examples. Disqus was a good example. So Disqus had about 18 million records breached. I think that was about 18 months ago. My data was in there. Always easy to verify a data breach when I see my own data in there. And I got in touch with them, and they took well under 7, I think that took about 24 hours between me getting in touch and actually having breach disclosure notices out there, and not sugarcoating it, not going, we take security seriously. Someone really, really good hacked us. You know, it was a sophisticated threat actor, which is a little bit dog ate my homework as far as I'm concerned. But, they sort of said, look, here's what happened, here's what we know, this is the way it is. And everyone kind of went, okay, that's a reasonable response. Imgur was the same thing. I disclosed to Imgur on Thanksgiving Day and spoke to their CIO. I pictured that he was like eating his turkey or something with his family, but they had disclosure out within 24 hours. The Australian Red Cross Blood Service, I mentioned before, had disclosure out in less than 72 hours, but it was the CEO doing press releases, and it was SMSs to everyone, and it was just the whole thing. The ones that tend to do it badly, I find are much more traditional organisations, or very small services that really have just never sort of thought this process through before. So I did a talk in Melbourne earlier this week, and I showed a website called Adult Fan Fiction. And it's basically like vampire porn, not pictures, just words. I don't know if that makes it better or worse. But anyway, they had a data breach, and I tried to, in fact, I showed the whole process. So here's the email I sent to the 2 published email addresses they had. There was no response. Here's like 2.5 weeks later, me loading into Have I Been Pwned. Here's them getting angry at me on their forum saying there wasn't breached. Here's me in the original email, like literally sharing the hashes, like take these hashes, compare it to the ones in your system. If they're the same, they're probably going to be breached. Here's where they said they're going to get a lawyer. that was like 9 months ago. No lawyer. So I find some companies are a little bit reactionary like that, but I guess in fairness to them, it's like this is a world they're not used to. You know, it's like, all they want to do is like write vampire porn, and suddenly some Australian guy pops up and says, I've got all your data. It's a very, very strange, well, it's strange for me, so in fairness. But it was a very strange experience for them too, I'm sure. All right, that's an answer you weren't expecting. Any other questions?
How do you keep on top of the breaches and like try and copy some of them? Is it independent research, or do people, because of your name, help you and provide you with
right, so the question was, how do I keep on top of the breaches? And it's largely what you started touching on the end, where people send them to me. So when I launched the service, It was mostly Adobe, and it was mostly Adobe because that was circulating really broadly. I had my personal account in there because I had a Macromedia account, yay. And I had my work account, and I had that data, and then I had like Gawker and Strat4 and like a total of 5 breaches. And then once the service went out, all these people went, hey, this is kind of cool, let us send you data. So now what's happening is that when we see things like this piece on the register the other day, there's a whole bunch of big services on there, people pop up and they say, look, as soon as I get the data, I'll give it to you, or I already have it, here it is. And I'm just sitting on hundreds of millions, possibly billions of different records of data that people have popped up and sent. And if you have a look, even the last few days, the most recent breaches is... Yep. How many times have I been sued? Amazingly none. In fact, the worst I've had, and if I'm honest, I'm still kind of surprised about this, the worst I've had is like the vampire porn guys, saying, you know, we're going to send lawyer. But there's a few things which I think mitigate that. And one of them is that I do always try and do disclosure. I try and pass the bar of what most people would consider reasonable effort to disclose. And then as soon as I can after that, go and do it. So, you know, 2.5 weeks for those guys, sent it to published emails. I think I publicly tweeted and said, does anyone have a security contact as well? Which is pretty much like a bat light for anyone that follows my Twitter account. So if someone after that then goes and says, you didn't tell us, it's like, come on. Also, I'm on the other side of the world. I'm not going to lie, that does help a little bit. I do feel a little bit protected. I mean, mind you, we're very friendly with Americans and British people, and where most of these data breaches come from. So there's that. I think it's a bit easier now as well because it does have such high profile that if a company that cared got upset, I mean, let's say it was, just for example, House. If they got upset and they tried to sue me for this when it was definitely legitimate, it'd been in the news, it's been out there, the press wouldn't be very kind. I'd make sure of that. So, you know, that would happen as well. And hey, look, if I do get sued, I'll make a good blog post, won't I? But no, look, it hasn't even come close to happening yet, and I do hope it doesn't, because, look, my view of this is that shit happens, breaches happen, how are we going to deal with it? And companies like the ones I mentioned before, like Discuss and Imager and Red Cross Blood Service, they recognise that and they go, okay, let's get on and try and deal with this. And I think the organisations that embrace it rather than fight it come out of it pretty well. Such high hopes for GDPR. I was so excited. I really was. And the reason I was excited is that I was excited about the prospect of there being penalties for egregiously bad security posture. So I'll give you an example of what I mean by this. So TalkTalk in the UK, they had a massive breach in late 2015, so before GDPR hit. They had a 17-year-old kid SQL map them and do allegedly £42 million worth of damage. So, yeah, absolutely catastrophic, huge impact, a whole bunch of personal data. And the Information Commissioner's Office, which is their regulator, the ICO, this company that earns £1.8 billion a year, they fine them £400,000. Now, to put this in perspective, if you earn $100,000 a year, that's like getting a $22 fine. That's lunch, right? Like a nice lunch, granted, but it's lunch. Like, you're not going to go, oh, I'm never going to do that again, otherwise I won't eat lunch one day. It's like, it is a bullshit amount of money to penalise an organisation. And that was the largest one they ever did. They equaled that with Carphone Warehouse later on. So GDPR came along and said, look, if you screw up badly enough, we're going to ping you 4% of gross annual worldwide turnover. And we're like, all right, well, that's more like £96,000. That would seem. This is good incentive. What I'm finding post-GDPR, and I was actually thinking about this in the car on the way over here, believe it or not, because I was just watching my tweets with GDPR popping up over and over again, is it's almost like GDPR is the hammer and everything is looking like a nail. So everyone seems to think that GDPR is going to fix everything now. Yeah, and in fact, the reason I was thinking about it is someone said, in fact, this relates to an earlier story, the Spotify thing before. This person posted on my blog and said, look, Spotify got hacked because my details are in there. And I'm like, no, they almost certainly didn't because you got a bad password and you re-use credentials. And he said, I'm going to exercise my right under GDPR to request information about the security incident. I said, well, you've got no construct under GDPR for that. You've got access to your personal information. You can make a subject access request and get that. That doesn't mean that they have to go and tell you internal information about security incidents against their system. This guy's convinced that like GDPR is the hammer I'm going to hit them with. So I hear that over and over again. I don't know that it's actually made a whole lot of difference to disclosure. Because you've got to remember, like GDPR just synergized a lot of different things we had across all the EU member states as well. There's still mandatory disclosure laws. On the other hand, in Australia, we had nothing until March last year. And we are actually seeing an uptick of disclosures, but I'm not sure that, certainly not any measurable way from my end, GDPR has really made a difference there. Has anyone seen any big fines on the GDPR? It's early too, and from what I've heard, like the regulators are massively overwhelmed. And here you go, I'll show you something interesting. Like, this is a secret thing, so are you still filming? Look, it actually got some traction really early on, but the thing that I've been kind of fascinated with lately is, and this, remember in the old days when you had the hit counter and you used to keep reloading your page to see how many hits it went? So my hit counter now is the Alexa rank, and I keep looking at the Alexa rank because I'm kind of fascinated by it. And the maybe 10% of the time, and I think part of it is because there's a bunch of familiar characters that pop up and send data. Some of them do actually ask to be attributed. So, for example, some of these recent ones on Have I Been Pwned, I have a window there somewhere, you'll notice that something like verifications.io, in this case it was Bob Diachenko. It's one that you all know, and this person contacted me and said, look, I've got a breach, which is allegedly this particular service. I was like, wow, holy shit, if that's real, that's going to be a massive story. And 24 hours later, they went, no, look, we've gone through it. It's just not legit. It's someone trying to pump up their ego or their credibility or get noticed or something like that. So it definitely happens. I think the main reason I'm really cautious of validating is that imagine if they get it wrong. So imagine if Howes hadn't had a data breach, and I loaded their data into the system, and I said, Howes had a data breach, and then there was negative press, and then there was actually some basis to send the lawyers. So I want to be super cautious about that. This is legit, and I'm going, oh boy. I better go and check all this again. But yeah, probably around about 10% of the time, and I check it super, super carefully. If I'm having trouble verifying, I will go back to the people in the breach, like I did with that BlueSnap breach pack one earlier on, and I'll say, look, I've got a piece of data, is this you? If the data doesn't check out, I normally still archive, but I archive everything. It gets archived offline on a NAS bolted to the floor, not connected to the internet. Because a bunch of these breaches are really useful to verify against the old one. You know, if someone says, hey, such and such a company's been breached again, and you hear this all the time with the likes of Dropbox, I want to go and validate it. Is this data new, or is it just the same stuff? Possibly rebranding.
Is it just you?
Is it just me? Yes.
So
if I die, my wife has my master password. It is. I find it funny actually because I get these emails from people like, we really like what the team has done. It's just me, it's like that laptop. that's about it. I take a bit of a guilty pleasure in trying to see how big I can make this on a shoestring. So a lot of Have I Been Pwned, in fact, the reason I built it wasn't just because I wanted to build a data breach service. I wanted to build stuff on Microsoft's Azure. You in America know that it's Azure. But so Azure is, I was doing some work in my old sort of corporate life with it, and I wanted to build something that wasn't Hello World. Like I wanted to build something in Angular. And this is the project I chose to build on that. So I've been having a lot of fun making bigger and bigger and bigger and trying to, in many cases, drive the cost down. So there's different talks I do for like developer-centric audiences around how, a good example is that collection one data that I loaded recently, there were something like 79 million requests to the API over the period of a week, and it cost about $34 to run that particular part of it. And that to me is just a fun geeky challenge. Like, how do I make it bigger and bigger and bigger, bring the cost down further and further? But yeah, it is just me doing it. And that's probably not sustainable. That's how it is today.
What other tools do you use besides this to verify some of these breaches?
All right, I'll give you a good example of verification. It's late, everyone's drinking beer, we can go here. That was a pretty serious incident because it was the same sort of data as Ashley Madison, and it basically indicated who was looking for hookup sex, which, you know, each to their own, is a very personal thing. You probably deserve the right to privacy. You go to the password reset page, you plug in an email address, and it comes back and says, oh, this address doesn't exist. You plug in another one, and it's like, this address does exist. So, oh, good on the enumeration there. So one of the things I'll very frequently do is when a data breach comes out, one of the first things I do is just regex out all the email addresses. So say the one today, they're like 19 million email addresses. And then I'll go through that and I'll grab mailinator addresses. You ever know mailinator? Just for those of you who don't, this isn't going to work, so we'll skip that. If we go to mailinator, which will tell you whether the address exists anyway, or you go here, because it's a public mailbox, it's designed for everyone to see, and if I see a password reset come in, I'll go, okay. So if I can pick like three random mailinator addresses out of an alleged breach, and every single one of them actually exists on the site, and particularly a breach, but my confidence level is now going to be pretty high. Ideally, I'd like to see a public disclosure notice, like with Powers, it's easy, public disclosure message. If not, then I'll contact them privately and I'll send them the data and hopefully get them to verify as well. And then if all those files and I can't get a response from them, I'll just load it anyway. Because that's like a level of due diligence I'm happy with. How do I maintain the passion I have? I just find it fascinating. You know? Like, I think what's really interesting about this industry is I just never know what's going to happen tomorrow. You know, like you wake up one day and there's just the weirdest stuff that's happened overnight. And it's everything from the sorts of data breaches you've seen here through to a lot of the nation state stuff recently. And it's the prevalence of it across the mainstream as well. I spoke about it a few times today. Like it's fascinating that my mum and dad, who are both 70-ish, can sort of open up their newspaper and see things related to my industry. I mean, if I had to just stay as a developer or as an architect, mum and dad aren't going to come to me tomorrow and come in tomorrow and say, you know, hey, I saw it in jQuery, it looks really cool. Like, it's just not going to happen. But they'll hear about data breaches and particularly with what I do now, I'll see them on the news or something like that. And I just find that really, really exciting. And I think it's getting more exciting because it's becoming such a hot button topic. And we know it all gets overblown and there's a lot of hyperbole, but it is a serious thing now, particularly with the nation state sort of stuff, and particularly with the number of devices and the amount of data we collect. So I just remain fascinated by it. And in fairness, like between you and I do feel burned out sometimes after that 733 million record thing, 773. There's another talk I do where I explained that I loaded that in the morning when I was heading to Norway for a few events, but I was catching up some friends here snowboarding first, and all I wanted to do was just switch off for a few days and go snowboarding. And I literally got thousands of emails about the thing. It burned me out. And in fact, if you look at my Twitter feed, you'll see it just went way, way down a little while ago because I just haven't been able to keep up. So I go through cycles, but I just think it's a fascinating industry.
All this information at
your
fingertips, have you ever been tempted to use it?
Have I ever been tempted to use this information for purposes, like just build a massive data breach service or something? Or what did you have in mind?
We'll talk later.
Come to me with ideas. To be honest, I haven't felt nefarious intent. And if I'm completely honest, I can't even think of a time where I might have taken someone's email address and password from data breach and logged in just to test it works. I don't actually think I've done that. I just think that in this industry, and I guess it's a bit like that I've got profile and exposure now as well, there's so many opportunities to do so much stuff that's entirely mainstream and legit. That's awesome, and particularly now with the amount of stuff I'm doing with government and law enforcement as well. Like I want to be really, really squeaky clean because I want to have plausible deniability. For want of a better term. But look, honestly, it's just such a buoyant industry and so much opportunity. I think that you must wonder, even the folks that are walking on that grey line, if they don't look at it and go, well, it looks pretty attractive over on the bright side, you know?
What's your thoughts on MageCart?
Thoughts on MageCart? So, I have to say that I'm kind of impressed. You know, like MageCart has been really interesting. It sounds like MageCart appears to be like multiple different groups and parties. They've just gotten into so many places, and they've gotten in with really, really simple implementations too. I mean, it's like exposed CMS, default admin credentials, things like this. I'm kind of more lamenting the fact that organizations are missing really, really basic things like content security policies and sub-resource integrity, which kind of fixes a lot of this stuff for free as well. But they seem to be really effective, and they seem to be able to keep doing what they're doing. I think, if anything, it's probably more reflective of how much just like woefully open stuff we have out there. I wonder how much other stuff is out there that we haven't yet discovered as well. Because it runs pretty silently. You know, until some, it seems to be actually, most of the time I get found out, it seems to be a credit card provider saying, hey, we send a lot of fraudulent transactions from cards that have all made a purchase at the same place.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, should that be the way we discover someone's got a malicious script on the page? So I'm a little bit impressed, I run a project with Scott Helm, who some of you know, called Report Your Eye, where we do like CSP reporting and stuff, and CSPs do fix. Oh man. Did malware tech create Cronus? I honestly have no idea. I've chatted to him a few times online. I've never met him in person. Like, he always seems like a nice guy, but I understand how a lot of people in this industry have come from other places as well. And I don't know, it's just a shame it was the US he got picked up and not the UK. I think it would have been very different then. But I do hope whatever the outcome is, they kind of wrap it up soon, because it must be painful for the guy at the moment. Yeah, well, yeah. No, but look, you seem like a decent bloke, and I hope it works out. I just don't know what that's going to look like. July, okay. So I heard he just got a bunch of stuff. What was it? He wanted to have some stuff not on the record because he got questioned on the duress or something, but... Yeah, no, putting myself in his shoes, whether you've done the wrong thing or the right thing, it'd be massively stressful to, like, finish a week, 2 weeks of partying, death and then get grilled by the FBI. Like, honestly, how much sense are you going to make? I don't know.
Is it possible to
expand
the other notifications using wildcard email addresses?
So is it possible to sign up for email notifications using wildcard email addresses? So just a bit of background on how this works underneath. And there is a Have I Been Pwned tag on my blog that's got more than 100 posts on it. And I write about pretty much all the underlying data structures. It sits on Azure Table Storage. And what's been really, really good about Azure Table Storage, this is like my day one decision, and the thing that's still probably the best decision I made today, is that table storage is the key value pair. So you have partition keys, you have row keys, and then you have n number of columns that you want to have after that. And the way the data structure works is that when I put an email address into Have I Been Pwned, the domain is a partition key and the alias is a row key. So my old Hotmail address is in there many times. I've got troyhunt@hotmail.com. So in the hotmail.com partition, I have a row called troyhunt.com, I have a column called websites, and it's just a semicolon delimited list of websites. The good thing about table storage is that it's super, super fast to look up by row and partition key. So when I search my email address, and just for those who haven't seen it, we can pull my email address up. Infinitely in terms of the record volume and traffic volumes, and it costs me about $50 a month, which is very, very cool. But you can't do stuff like that. So that's the trade-off I had to make.
Do you make any money off
Pwned? I do in a couple of ways. So number one is I do get a surprising number of donations. And trust me, it surprises me. And every now and then, someone donates something really nice. So the other day, someone donated $250. I'm like, sweet, okay, it's free, like you don't have to do it. Maybe I'll go and spend it on something nice. There are also a number of commercial services that some paying customers do use. And I try and strike this balance between being transparent about it, so I've blogged about it specifically and I write about it every now and then, but not being promotional about it, because I don't want that to be the thing that defines the service. So, you know, that's something which just organically grows when someone pops up and they, you know, a good example would be an InfoSec company says, you know, we've got 100 customers, we'd really like to be able to do domain searches for them and we'll offer that as part of our services. Well, you're not going to be able to verify that you control the domain, so here's another way of doing it. So it does actually make some money out of it, which is unexpected and nice, and I want to make sure that it remains an ancillary outcome of running the service. Any more?
Going back to the Okta approach extension, I believe you were listing out similar things that just the users
now. Yeah.
Do you see any, concerns where users go forward with their
success? So Google released a browser extension last month that allows you to do similar sorts of things to Pwned passwords. And I kind of thought it was a bit funny because a bunch of people started tweeting and they're like, oh, Troy, like Google's cutting your lunch. I don't know if I say that in America. They're, they're cutting into your profit margins. I'm like, you know, like Pwned passwords, like 100% of everything with Pwned passwords is free. I definitely don't make a sense of that. It's deliberately designed to be like maximum saturation. So I don't care about it. Google actually emailed me in advance. Actually, they DM'd me. Someone DM'd me in advance. But they DM'd me on the 17th of January, which was the 16th of January here when I loaded that massive data set and then I was going snowboarding, not thinking about anything. So I didn't see it. And then the whole thing loaded and they DM'd me again. And I ended up having a meeting with them. And we had a really good chat. And I was like, look, honestly, if what you do gets people more aware of the fact that there is this thing which is password reuse and data breaches and credential stuffing, then that's really cool. Google also can do a number of things that I will never be able to do. So one of the things they can do is they can look at a credential stuffing list and they can say how many of these are accurate. Because they've got, I don't know, what, a billion accounts or something? Like Google's got a lot of accounts. So they can look at it and go, how many of these actually match the real usernames and passwords people do? I can't do that. Number two is that if they have an extension that warns people, they can actually see the change in behavior. So they can say, well, we showed this to a million people, how many of them then went and changed their password? So on that basis alone, I really like it. When I spoke to them, I said, look, you know, no matter how good a job you do of this, there will always be people who think you're just stealing their data, because you're Google. So there'll always be that. But look, I think the net positive, or the net value of that is positive, because the vast majority of subscribers are normally about consumers that are not going to be worried about that anyway.
Yeah, since this is basically an AppSec-centered event, I was curious, like, how often do you have your website tested?
Every moment of every day, our website is tested. I guarantee it. It's a combination of let's call them unsanctioned pen tests. Yeah, that'll do. That happens all the time. Occasionally, I do get people providing feedback. Nothing that I can actually think of, which is very notable. Most of the feedback I get these emails that worry the hell out of me. Like, I'll get an email where someone says, I've found a vulnerability with your site, do you have a bug bounty? And I'm like, oh shit, this is going to be bad, it's going to be all over the news or something like that. And then they'll come back and say something like, it's been there for ages now, it's like, you don't have DMARC configured on your DNS. It's like, really? I was thinking I had like SQL injection and I'm like, all my customers are going to be out there and I'm going to have a major problem. Look, separately to that, I mean, obviously I do what I can do. There's a few friends that do, I guess, unofficial tests as well, but I have not gone through the process of a full pen test. I have a few times about maybe doing a bug crowd style thing on it. To be honest as well, Site is so simple. For the most part, it's like an API sitting on the table storage. But I think the optics of it, if you like, would be good to run something like that. They're actually taking the tables away.
Last question over there.
Last question over there.
Have you seen any interesting defensive strategies against whatever stuff you attack from a LinkedIn perspective? There's a lot of products out there. Any recent one that surprises you? Do you see that as a trend?
So it's an interesting question. So have I seen any defensive strategies, like blitzing strategies, against credential stuffing attacks? You're right, there's a lot of products out there. There's a lot of companies that like to charge you a lot of money for them as well. To be honest, I haven't drilled down into many of them. I've had a number of chats with Shape Security. They sort of tick the same box as 1Password, and that everyone's spoken there has been super cool and very interesting what they do. I think a lot of these cases, they don't want to talk too much about how they actually do it. A lot of it ends up being a combination of things that are in Pwned passwords and reputation basis and UBA and sort of stuff. But I have not seen solutions that don't end up costing a lot of money in order to achieve the end result. A funny story, and I can't say who this is because I'm very upset, but one of the stories I kept hearing was someone trying to sell very expensive solutions to companies and really struggling to do it. And companies with very big names, many of you know, then turn around and go, well, why don't we just use Pwned passwords because we trust Troy and have it been Pwned. So, oh, crap. but, you know, that seems to be, for most companies, there's probably very little, if any, credential stuffing defense whatsoever. Maybe, like, recapture or something like that. Or at best, something like Pwned passwords. But it's honestly, it's a hard problem. I'll give you one last anecdote. I had a company contact me, and they wanted to use Have I Been Pwned commercially because they wanted to try and see which of their customers had been in data breaches. And when I kind of kept picking away at what the underlying problem was, they said, look, we're undergoing credential stuffing attacks. We need to know which of our customers have been in some of these recent data breaches because that's going to heighten their likelihood of account takeover. And I sort of said, all right, out of curiosity, like what kind of, because I was thinking, you know, just drop anti-automation in as a first defense. What kind of rate of attempts are you seeing? And they're like, oh, you know, there's like one attempt every 10 seconds. Said, well, that doesn't seem very impressive. You know, what else can you tell me? And I said, well, it starts at business hours and finishes at the end of the business day. And what it turned out to be is like, one person somewhere, let's say they're in Ukraine just because they get chucked under the bus all the time. One person sitting in Ukraine, aligned like Ukrainian business hours, sitting there like literally entering username and passwords into the web page, assumably rotating through IP addresses as well. And I sort of thought, well, how do you stop that? You know, like that's a really, like without making life really, really hard for legitimate users, that's a really hard problem. And there's someone literally there doing keystrokes that will pass certain defenses, and then manually submitting it at an allowable rate across multiple IP addresses. It's really hard to stop someone with legitimate credentials coming to your site when they're doing it like that. So I think this is one of the great unsolved problems that we still have. I think we're done, but I don't know what we're doing now if we're hanging around or doing a dinner. That took all about 2 seconds. All right, I'm going to open my bag and pull out the stickers from between all my other stuff that's in there. And if anyone wants stickers, come and grab them. Thank you very much for having me.